Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to tonight's Visions and Voices signature event at the University of Southern California. Please take this moment to turn off your cell phones. Please welcome the President of the University of Southern California, C.L. Max Nikias.
Good evening, everyone. I have to tell you, we are up for a treat tonight. This is a very, very special evening at the University of Southern California as we welcome two very special members of our Trojan family back to campus. Dana and David Dornsife are very well known to all of us. Our College of Letters, Arts, and Sciences bears their names in perpetuity, and they stand as stellar role models for our students. As you know, the goal of Visions and Voices is to inspire our students, to challenge them intellectually, and to help them become more positive world citizens. Through their philanthropic work, Dana and David Dornsife exemplify these ideals. In many parts of Africa, people struggle for access to clean drinking water, a problem that leads to serious diseases and shortened life spans. The Dornsifes have partnered with the World Vision to fight this problem, bringing much needed water to more than 4.5 million people across 10 different nations in Africa. These projects ensure life-sustaining water, sanitation, and hygiene for these communities and dramatically improve their daily lives. The benefits are incalculable. In his book, A Different Kind of Courage, writer Jim Horsley described the trip he took with David, a trip in which they experienced firsthand the fruits of the Dornsifes' work with World Vision. Mr. Horsley wrote, 3 hours of swirling sand and back-breaking road brought us to the edge of this village. The landscape was barren, but even with the windows rolled up, we could hear the celebration. Stepping from our jeep, we were surrounded by villagers. Drums and music pounded our ears as we walked into a group of dancing women. Water was coming out of the ground, and the people were ecstatic. For the first time in decades, their village would have clean water and their children could enjoy good health. I had never in my life seen so many people so grateful for a gift. Tonight it is we who will receive a gift as the Dornsifes share their unique journey with us. In 2011, our university awarded David and Dana Dornsife the University Medallion. In 2012, USC awarded Dana and David a well-deserved honorary degrees. Our intention was to recognize their humanitarian efforts, which are tremendously broad in scope and enormously profound in impact. The Dornsifes also generously support micro-enterprise and literacy projects in West Africa, and these efforts have vastly raised the prospects of these nations' people. Dana founded and serves as president of Lazarex Cancer Foundation, which supports end-stage cancer patients. David is a distinguished trustee of our university, serves as chairman of the board of the Herica Corporation, and is vice president of the HETCO Foundation, which supports health and education. Both he and Dana serve on the board of the USC Brain and Creativity Institute, as well as the boards of numerous other philanthropic organizations. Together, they have committed themselves to bettering our world. Tonight's event represents what Visions and Voices is all about: championing the arts and humanities, championing knowledge that is pressed into service to benefit society, and championing a spirit of generosity coupled with a strong commitment to helping others. So, ladies and gentlemen, I have the distinct honor and the great pleasure of presenting to you the Dornsifes. Let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you. Tonight we'd like to talk about a program we are working on in Africa through World Vision called WASH, W-A-S-H. The WASH program is made up of three separate areas of focus: water, sanitation, and hygiene. The challenge: more than 3.4 million people worldwide die each year from water, sanitation, and hygiene-related diseases. Worldwide, every 21 seconds, a child dies from water-related disease. This is mainly from diarrhea. In Africa, there are 345 million people without access to clean water. Dana and I have chosen to work through World Vision to change these numbers in 10 countries in Africa. In West Africa, we're working in Mali, Niger, and Ghana. In South Africa, Zambia, Malawi, and Mozambique. In East Africa, Ethiopia, Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda. Separately, we are working with ECHO, another nonprofit, to work in Burkina Faso to change agricultural practices in West Africa. And there's Burkina Faso. We chose to work in Africa because we had access to experienced personnel and management through World Vision. World Vision is an international Christian relief organization that administers its services in individual countries in area development programs, small geographic areas that may consist of dozens of villages with a population ranging from several hundred to a few thousand. World Vision staff work to improve the lives and education of the people in the area development program over a period of up to 15 years, at which time it should be sustainable and they can leave the area. It is in this setting that we bring in sanitation and hygiene practices and eventually clean water, or WASH. So why are we doing this? Let us show you the conditions as they exist prior to WASH.
For rural villagers, life is very difficult in Africa. Every day, women face the enormous challenge of simply keeping their families alive. The one thing they need the most is the one thing they have the least of: clean water. Rivers, ponds, and seasonal springs are the most common places to gather water. This woman is gathering water from a local water hole. The water is obviously contaminated, but it's the only source of water for this village of approximately 300 people. In this case, with a baby on her back, this woman has to use a cup to fill her bucket because the water source has almost dried up and is too shallow to scoop the water up with the bucket. Again, another source of obviously contaminated water is this village's only supply. In Africa, the average distance a woman must walk to a source of water is nearly 7 kilometers round trip. Can you imagine walking the equivalent of 4.2 miles perhaps even several times a day, to provide your family with adequate, although probably contaminated, water. Unfortunately, these women don't have to imagine, and this is their reality every day. And so the women and their children walk. Instead of going to school, they form water caravans, going to the nearest source of water. Safe water, one of the basic necessities of life, is especially critical for children who are the most vulnerable to water-related disease. Lack of access to clean water and good sanitation and hygiene practices has a profound effect on every aspect of life. You have to consider the entire impact in order to understand the severity of the issue. In Africa, millions of hours are lost annually because women and their children must collect and haul water for home use, which is almost always contaminated. Hours that could be spent on childcare and development, education, agricultural production, and life-sustaining economic activities. In addition, the contaminated water causes disease and sickness.
When a river or spring is not near, a hand-dug well is an alternative. This may seem reasonable until you understand what is involved in digging these wells by hand. Note the camel waiting his turn. I got the water first. Animals sharing water wells with humans is a source of further contamination and disease. Let's talk about how villagers have constructed wells for years in Africa. This village is digging a well not too far from where we drilled a borehole that was awaiting water quality results. So the villagers continued to dig because we weren't sure if the water quality would be okay. They had worked for 1 year, and at this point we're down 130 feet with unsupported walls. The US standard is no more than 5 feet, and if your employee gets hurt and an over 5 foot wall collapsed on your employee, you can be criminally prosecuted. They're 130 feet. But based on our knowledge of where we had to go to get water, they still have another 130 feet and another year. So 2 years of digging. We moved our drilling equipment in, struck water, completed our well, and left in 1 week. They tie ropes to the men to lower them in and out of the well shaft and use buckets tied to rope to remove the dirt excavated by hand. Every few hours, the men are hauled out and another crew is lowered back in.
We're all familiar with or have at least heard about conditions such as chronic diarrhea and diseases like cholera, typhoid, and malaria. Diseases that we don't have to be concerned with any longer in the United States because of access to clean water and good sanitation and hygiene practices. In Africa, death by these diseases is common, especially amongst children. Let's talk about a few diseases that we're not familiar with in the United States. Guinea worm is an example of a waterborne disease caused by a parasite. This young girl is at a local medical clinic in Ghana for a guinea worm extraction. There is no medicine you can take for guinea worm, and as the worm approaches maturity, it is very painful and leaves its victim feeling sick and completely drained of energy. People swallow the larva that causes the guinea worm when they drink contaminated water. It takes about 12 months for the guinea worm to mature. The worm typically migrates to the lower extremities of the body, where it secretes an enzyme that forms a painful blister on the skin, providing a hole where it can exit the body. When the mature worm comes in contact with the water, it releases millions of larvae through the blister that contaminate the water source. People drink the contaminated water, and the process begins all over again. This is a guinea worm extraction in process. Using a device that resembles a crochet hook, a clinician hooks the worm through a slit in the skin and begins to pull it out. This is a delicate procedure because the worm can break off and regenerate. Here the extraction is almost completed. This worm was almost 25 inches long. It's not unusual for people to have more than one worm at a time and be affected many times over the course of their lifetime. Please note that this is not a medical device. This is the actual guinea worm. Another disease that's easily managed with the availability of safe water is trachoma. Trachoma is caused by a bacteria called chlamydia, which is contagious. There are four stages of trachoma. The first two can be treated with antibiotics, but this is not a sustainable cure because people are constantly exposed to the bacteria and infection occurs over and over again. We are constantly exposed to chlamydia, but we don't get trachoma because we have access to clean water for hygiene purposes. Children who suffer from trachoma may be blinded by the age of 12. According to the World Health Organization, worldwide, currently 8 million people are visually impaired by trachoma, and there are 84 million active cases of the disease. You can see where a bacteria has formed scar tissue underneath this little girl's upper eyelid, where the tissue appears white in color, as opposed to normally healthy red tissue. Repeated exposure to the bacteria causes a buildup of scar tissue under the eyelids, eventually causing the eyelid to turn under. Here is an advanced case where the cornea is continuously abraded by the lashes of the turned under eyelid. This woman is completely blind and obviously suffers through every day. Her eyes are constantly weeping. She is in pain. We all know how uncomfortable it is when you have something in your eye. It's, you know, it gets your immediate attention, and whatever you're doing, you have to stop and address it right away. Yet she lives with that condition every minute of every day. You can see the opacity of her cornea, preventing her from seeing anything. In some instances, trachoma affects up to 40% of a village, causing additional burden to an already burdened community. The most staggering statistic about trachoma is that one tablespoon of clean water daily, just a palmful of clean water wiped across your eyes, is enough to prevent this disease from occurring at all. We've shown you the conditions that exist in many parts of rural Africa, and now you have a better understanding of the impact that lack of access to clean water, sanitation, and hygiene can have. So what are we doing about it? Clean water is simply not enough. We need to take a holistic approach that includes water, sanitation, and hygiene to bring about the behavioral changes needed to improve the quality of life and prevent disease. And it must all be done in a sustainable way. Sustainability, sustainability, sustainability. We cannot repeat that enough. There's no point in entering a country and doing all of this hard work together if once we leave, you know, all the good that is done gets undone. In philanthropy, people refer to the three T's: time, talent, and treasure. Dave and I add a fourth T, the trenches. We believe it's imperative to have the first-hand understanding of the problem and witness the effects of your proposed solutions in order to achieve positive and sustainable results. Let me share a story with you about a group of well-meaning people who spent a lot of time and money to bring water to a village in Samburu, Kenya. A nonprofit from Sweden installed a state-of-the-art diesel engine-driven pump system along with piping, valves, and a holding tank for a village of about 400 people. The installation cost was over $75,000. The installation was completed and the Swedish group celebrated their success with the villagers and returned home. Dave and I happened to be in this village 28 days later. All of the valves were ruined. The engine was seized from dirty fuel and dirty oil, so the pump no longer worked. No one took the time to work with the villagers to teach them about maintenance and operation of the pump, and the nearest source of clean diesel fuel was an hour away in a Jeep that the villagers didn't have. This was an unfortunate development and one that could have been avoided. The decisions about design and installation of the system were made in Sweden instead of on the ground in Samburu, where they could take into consideration the many factors that could affect the ultimate outcome. I'm certain this group of people would be devastated to know that their project was defunct in a matter of weeks, and the villagers were back to using contaminated water sources. But they are not alone. Our own personal experience involved years of effort building a sustainable water project in West Africa, beginning in 1999 with World Vision. We had many wins, but we also had some misses. We regrouped and refined our approach to achieve better results over time. By 2009, we were bringing water and, very inconsistently, sanitation and hygiene to 200,000 new people a year. In 2010, based on the results of the program, the quality of the management team, and improvements in technology, we approached World Vision about ramping things up. We made a significant multi-year commitment that was a funding keystone and attracted new financial partners. We now have an expanded WASH program in 10 countries throughout Africa, moving towards serving 1.4 million new people a year. And in many villages, the sanitation, latrine construction, and hygiene component is approaching 100% of their homes. The point is that if we weren't in the trenches and didn't go to Africa every year to be involved in the work, we wouldn't have developed better solutions and recognize the opportunity to ramp up the program. In the sustainability category, after 20 years, 79% of World Vision wells are still functioning, which is far above the norm. At the UN Water Conference in Stockholm in 2010, the UN presented that only 50% of NGO or non-governmental organization wells installed were still operating after 3 years, 50% after 3 years, 20% after 5 years. That's why, you know, we ask you to remember our Samburu, Kenya experience.
So how do we get the job done? There are many ways of providing clean water to the villages, and I will elaborate on a few of these. The first is a catchment structure. Can you point to the rock structure? The water flow from the spring is captured by a tiered rock structure. A catchment has the potential of serving several thousand people. A gravity-fed pipeline then runs down the mountain from the catchment to the villages. You see that? And the water flows to a water point near each village. And that particular pipeline could probably supply hundreds of these water points. The next method is the use of a hand auger. It's based on old concept, but it's been updated technically. This is a relatively new addition to our program, and in certain geological conditions, it can be used to effectively drill wells up to 120 feet deep. Dana, maybe you'd point out the drilling foreman in the white hat in the middle there. These are the tools that are used at the end of the hand auger drill shaft to work through various soil conditions. We have also added a smaller drilling rig that is a third of the cost of the large drill rig and can be moved with a pickup truck to get into a variety of areas that our larger rigs can't get into. This unit can drill 50 to 300 foot deep wells very effectively. This is our conventional large drill rig that works effectively in all geographic areas. Some of the conditions that we encounter in the Rift Valley in East Africa, which goes up through Kenya and into Ethiopia, are very difficult drilling conditions. While most hand pump wells that we dig can only be 300 feet deep because the pump shaft becomes too heavy at 300 feet for the women to overhaul it, this drill rig is capable of going deeper if we have special conditions. Other sources of water are small dams and conventional springs on flat land. After successfully drilling a well in a village, a hand pump is installed and a concrete pad is used around the hand pump to keep the area clean. We have recently added the use of solar panels to power an electric pump for some larger villages of 500 or more. We fence in the solar panels, and the village has the obligation to provide 24-hour guard service to prevent theft of the panels. The solar-powered pump then elevates the water into a holding tank where it feeds several water points over a large area by gravity. This picture shows the tank and one of the several water points that this tank would surface. A novel concept that we added to our 2010 and subsequent business plans is cost per beneficiary. As we surveyed the management teams in each country prior to going in and doing our business plan, they identified what they needed, and we found out that a dam might cost $120 per beneficiary for wash versus a borehole and hand pump that was only about $65 per beneficiary. We eliminated the projects that had a very high cost per beneficiary so we could serve more people with fewer dollars. Our management found the small drill rig and the hand augers drastically lowered the costs below our original target. Since 2010, we went from an estimated cost of $68 per beneficiary. That was our original business plan estimated cost per beneficiary, to $50 per beneficiary of wash at the end of 2013. So an $18 per beneficiary decrease because of using some of these new ideas. The $50 consists of $40 for bringing the water and $10 for bringing the sanitation hygiene. Also, the lower cost of the small rigs and the hand augers allowed us to get more units into the field, increasing the number of people we serve in a shorter period of time. Prior to implementing these, as Dana said, these changes, we were serving about 200,000 people per year, and now we're approaching 1.4 million people per year.
So Dave has addressed the water part of WASH, and now I'd like to talk about the sanitation and hygiene pieces. Sanitation committees are formed at the schools, and this is one of the sanitation committees, I believe, in Uganda. The older children are responsible for teaching the younger children about good sanitation and hygiene practices. They also bring home these practices to their parents. Dave and I had a personal Q&A session with these children. They completely embraced the concepts and importance of sanitation and hygiene to improve their lives. They realized very rapidly what clean water and good hygiene and sanitation practices can do to the quality of their lives. And they just were so expressive about not being sick and, you know, being able to wash their hands and take baths and you know, have food growing to sustain them when they're hungry. And so it didn't take very long for them to understand what we were trying to accomplish there. The showstopper was their struggle on how to communicate their knowledge with their parents in their terms without quarrel, and to incorporate these practices into their lives at home.
This is a latrine at a school that was recently constructed in Malawi. It's a model of what we were doing at schools throughout Africa. Though some schools had a limited number of latrines, most had nothing at all, which led to open elimination around the school. The addition of latrines has drastically improved the level of sanitation at the schools, the health of their children, and the awareness of its importance. With the use of latrines, young girls are now staying in school and continuing their education. Previously, they often ended their education when they began menstruation. This is a photo of the interior of that latrine. This is a hand washing station outside of a latrine at a primary school. It's simple, but it gets the job done and teaches the children the importance of hand washing. As part of bringing water to an area development program, a local water and sanitation committee is established that's responsible for the use of the water, maintenance of the source, and enforcement of sanitation rules. Let's talk about wash at home. Latrines are also used to promote safe sanitation practices in the home. Our buddy Sam Diara here is demonstrating the use of the latrine and the latrine cover, if you could point that out, that World Vision provides to reduce odor and the presence of flies and insects that discourage the use of the latrine. Latrines are located a safe distance from the water supply in close proximity to households to stop open defecation, a common practice in Africa, which contributes to the spread of disease and contaminates water sources. This is another example of a household latrine. Again, a safe distance from the water source and next to the home. Our goal is to have a latrine at every household. Recently, one of our most effective strategies is to have the Women's Sanitation Committee monitor open defecation in each of their villages. The women go out and investigate the incidents of open defecation in the village and in the fields. The positive results are that social pressure has become an effective tool to enforce use of the latrines. This is an example of a household latrine with a hand washing facility just outside of it. They're using a small plastic cup that's perforated at the bottom, allowing water to flow through to wash their hands after using the latrine. This is a simple shower. People used to bathe in streams and rivers, contaminating the water source and then concurrently exposing themselves to waterborne diseases. This is a dish storage rack, keeping the dishes up off the floor and away from livestock that can contaminate the eating surface. The dishes are stored face down to reduce the spread of disease from insects. World Vision is emphasizing the importance of a clean cooking area for food preparation to promote better health conditions. This is a kitchen, apart from the sleeping structure, that is used only for food preparation, with very limited access to keep food prep as sanitary as possible. Malaria nets are being distributed for use in sleeping areas to minimize the incidence of malaria. A laundry pad is provided so that women can wash clothes safely and don't have to expose themselves to guinea worm and other waterborne diseases that they would encounter from lakes and streams. All of these measures, though very simple, make a huge difference in the occurrence of disease and vastly improve health and welfare, especially for children who are most vulnerable. These are all examples of sanitation and hygiene initiatives that the World Vision Wash program addresses.
So this is a new photo that we've added to our collage. This is a flag the Ethiopian government presents to villages where 100% of the homes have latrines. The translation from Amharic is open defecation free village. The villagers are very proud to have this recognition, and when we come to a village that has gotten this flag, usually the village elders will be waiting out at the front of the village with the flag flying, and that's where we do our greetings, under the open defecation-free village. Integral to our WASH program is CLTS, which is community-led total sanitation. This was a concept developed in India, and we've really begun using it in Africa. CLTS is an innovative program for mobilizing communities to completely eliminate open defecation. It focuses on the behavioral change needed to ensure real and sustainable improvements. Investing in community mobilization instead of simply constructing toilets. Across all facets of our WASH program in 2013, we've exceeded our 2013 targets as indicated by the percentages on the right. This is 14 years in the making. First was wells and water points. The second line is sanitation facilities. The third line is hand washing facilities. Fourth is WASH committees formed. This is the committee of the women that you saw. And fifth is communities trained in pump maintenance and repair. As of the end of 2013, in Africa, we are now bringing water, sanitation, and hygiene to a new person every 30 seconds. Every 30 seconds. Children are going to school rather than spending their time hauling water. Women tend to their homes and are able to take on minor micro enterprise pursuits. Can you see all the chickens in there?
Chicken farm.
Instead of spending their time fetching contaminated water. This makes a huge socioeconomic change in their lives. Part of the school program is to talk about nutrition, teach children how to garden, and provide their own food, improving health and well-being. And this picture and the next one are what it's all about. Our team efforts are having an impact. The criteria for successful well installation is to allow a woman or child to get water and return home within a 30-minute round trip. We can say from years of observation from numerous trips to Africa that this is truly a life-changing event that can be accomplished in a short period of time. This concludes our presentation. Thank you for your time and attention. Right on. Thank you. So we have time for questions.
Absolutely. Yes.
It's a little bit hard. They're cooking me up here with these lights. So if you have a question, if you'd hold your hand up, and then we'll do the best to hear, and then we'll answer the question. Oh, you do.
Oh,
and I have one of my friends from Ghana, Brima Oppenberry is here. He's a hydrogeologist from Ghana. He's currently at Desert Research Institute in Reno, and he travels each trip. He travels to Africa with Dana and I. So if we wind up with a highly technical question, I'll get your answer.
I have one other thing I just need to tell you. On our last trip, we went to a village, and
show the picture.
I don't know if I can get back to it. Yeah, you'd have to go back.
Okay.
Well, you can if you want to. Anyway, we had the village chief and his wife there, as we usually always do, and I noticed that the chief's wife was smiling very grandly at Dave and scowling very seriously at me. And after our meeting, where we had our formalities, she started talking to me, and I really had no idea what she was saying, but I could tell she was not very happy. And basically what she was telling me was that my husband was very handsome and very big, and that she wanted me to leave him there at her village, and that I could take her husband home with me.
We ask Brian.
And in addition to Brian being very knowledgeable about water, he was also able to negotiate me bringing Dave home.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you, Brian. Okay. Okay.
I have a question about the pump that you had in the next to the last picture. You and your wife are standing in front of a blue well. Was that a pump well?
Yes, that was a hand pump well.
Do those last longer than the 3 to 5 years that most of them are falling apart in?
They do, but as part of our program, you know, we teach the villagers. The water committee not only handles the water distribution and collects a small amount of money for it, but they know how to maintain the pump. That particular pump just has a couple gears. We buy one particular pump, India Mark II, and we use it in all our projects. And the village can maintain 95% of what happens to the pumps. So those are the pumps that we're having the 20-year life with.
What's the approximate cost of sinking a pump like that?
With the big drill rig, the cost for a well like that with the hand pump is about $12,000 US. For the smaller drill rig that I showed the picture of, that cost is down around $6,000. And for the hand auger, the total cost is around $2,500.
Are the local people able to learn how to maintain that well for a couple of years?
Yes, they are.
Okay, thank you
that's,
very much.
That's part of the teaching, and we work real hard on that.
And thank you very much for your efforts in this regard.
Oh, thank you.
God bless you.
It's important to understand that maintenance, again, in the sustainability arena, you know, we don't want to be parked in these villages forever. So we do everything we can to impart as much knowledge as possible and as much autonomy as possible so that at some point we're able to, you know, back out slowly and they can continue life in a sustainable way with water sanitation and hygiene.
Yes, in the middle there. We have had some incidences of that, but really for the scope of what we're doing, it hasn't been too bad. Part of using this area development program concept, which is completely different from other charitable water groups, is that we go in with the idea that we want to work with these villages, and the village elders have to buy into the fact that we're going to work on education and food storage and so forth. And then after a couple of years, we bring in sanitation and then eventually water. So we've had a long-term relationship with them. And we do find that after we bring the water, other villages nearby will say, can we be part of the area development program? But it's an ongoing program. And the World Vision staff in the country works with the government officials. And we lay this out, and it's just a model that we follow. We don't just come in and put a water well in one village and you know, by chance. This is a long program. Yes?
How do you sustainably sanitize the water
product from the wells? The aquifer, Africa's got a marvelous aquifer. And all of the water that we leave through the hand pump has been certified by World Health Organization for trace minerals. We are able to deal with fluoride and arsenic by putting the water into a box, and it passes through a mineral box, and the good water comes out the other. But the greatest percentage of our wells by far are just fine the way they are. Yes, in the middle? Okay.
I'm Mr. and Mrs. Dornsife. I wanted to thank you for all you do to support this cause that you've chosen to take on and for supporting the education of students like myself here at USC. I was just wondering what I and students in USC can do to support your cause and help enhance your efforts.
We've got some people from World Vision here. And maybe the best thing would be to have them, after we're done, I'll have them walk up to the front, and then they'd be glad to talk to you, because we do use students, and that is working well, and we'd love to have you help. And thank you very much for the nice things you said about us. We're very blessed. We're very blessed, and we really feel good in having a chance to give back. But this world needs a lot of work. And so if you want to join us, you're on, babe. Yes, now, the lady in the middle.
You did make mention of trachoma. I didn't hear you mention bilharzia at all, which is also a waterborne disease.
Yes.
It's long since I've been in Africa, several decades. Is that something that's been solved, or are you still running into that as well?
We still are, but it's seasonal. And once we put the well in, we stop all of that. We got to get the people out of the rivers and the streams and the lakes and getting the water out of the pump, and then we can control all that.
We have a question over here.
Okay.
Hi. Oh, hi. I just wanted to know, how is the government reacting to you guys coming into the different countries? And are they helping you guys in your efforts, or are they just really not at all?
That's a very good question, and I'm going to say that of late, we have had much better reception from the governments in the countries that we're working in. You have to understand that the majority of the time, we are working in the very, very rural areas of these countries, and so they don't get a lot of government official visits, and you know, there's not a lot of credit that a government official can take for, you know, working with them. So for the most part, you know, we've operated under the radar. But because of the consistency of our presence and efforts there, and ours being our whole team, World Vision, and many of our other partners, we have had incredible impact, really, on the quality of life for these villages. And the governments are now recognizing the impact that we're having, and they are now stepping up, and you know, we showed you the flag. You know, that's a government program in Ethiopia. They're really embracing these wash techniques, and in many instances, they're actually reaching out to us now and asking us to partner with them on some other projects to bring water to, you know, certain other villages that we may not be working in. So I would say it's definitely getting better and moving in a very positive direction.
On the left side, maybe.
I think it's Mel, yeah.
Hello. I wanted to ask, how many foreign professionals are involved in the average project? How many projects will a foreign professional do on any trip to a country? And overall, what is the cost of keeping a foreign professional on the ground in one of these countries where you do your projects?
We generally use local people, and not too often, very rarely do we have expatriates there. I don't know the cost of keeping an expat on a project.
I don't mean expatriates, I mean Americans, for example, that are flown into Uganda to work on these projects with you?
In Uganda, all of our staff is Ugandan, or you might have somebody from Chad or somebody from Ghana and all that, but we don't use any Americans.
Thank you.
You bet. Brima's got an answer on that, too.
There is the worry that, you know, if you have expatriates working in Africa, they are paid a lot of money, and that is true. The World Vision Program tries to minimize this cost by using local professionals. What World Vision does is that they have learning centers in each of the regions that World Vision works in, and we try to bring in people who train the people on how to manage the programs. By that, when you do that, then the cost is reduced. So I was a product of that after my BS in Ghana. I worked on a project in Ghana as a Ghanaian. And World Vision staff, about 98% of them are locals. But there are other programs that you fly in expatriates, and they may consume about half you know, the project budget, which is normally very high and doesn't do very much to the country. But World Vision has a different model. Yeah.
Okay, some gal in the middle there.
And just one further comment on that, though. In addition to the financial savings that we have by using local people, you have to understand that almost every village has its own dialect. So it's very difficult, it would be very difficult for an expatriate to go, you know, throughout Africa and to be able to communicate with, villages. And so using local people, it does a couple of things. First of all, it establishes trust amongst the villagers where, you know, you've got people who don't look like them coming in and wanting to help them, but still, you know, there's that question of, can we really trust these guys, right? But when you have local representation, it kind of breaks through that barrier. It drastically improves the communication, and that's where we really begin to get the buy-in on with the sanitation committees and the training and, you know, all around working towards sustainability. So the model of using local people has been very effective.
There's a guy all the way in the back with his hand up.
Yeah, I'd like to kind of infer a little. So you're actually saying that you don't have a formal memorandum of understanding with the government, the state that's working.
I don't mean to say that. World Vision establishes relations with the government, has memorandum of understanding. That's all done, but that's done, and then that is effective for years and years and years. And so we follow in where World Vision has been for a while with this area development program and come in with the water operation. Other questions?
Mel?
Oh, hi, Mel.
Great presentation.
Thank you.
I was just wondering how many gallons of pure water per beneficiary do you require? Do you need to...
Oh, I need help on that one.
Brian will know that.
Yeah, the WHO stipulates that about 20 liters, which is about 5 gallons of water per person per day, and that is used for drinking. The sanitation that David Bennett talked about will also be used for some of that. So it's about 20 liters per person per day. But as communities devolve, then the water per capita increases. Just like in the U.S., we have an average of about 100 gallons per person per day. So we expect that, you know, in developing countries, the more water, the more people use water, the more sanitary the areas, you know, they live in. So we want to prevent waste, but we also want to give them enough water so that they are able to use it for sanitary.
Thank you, yeah. Rama.
And we have a question.
Thanks. Here. That's the first time we've been asked that question.
Yes.
It started my church. Went and signed up for 400 of the kids where you pay $24 a month and support a child in a third world. And we went over, and so they asked four people to go over, see the kids in a slum in Nairobi, and come back and report to the church. And I went twice, and I was just sick of these other three guys that were with me because they were complaining about the food and the hotels, and we're in this terrible slum where people were dying right and left. And so I just said to the church, I'm not going anymore. And then I went to World Vision and said, is there another project that I can get involved in where I don't have to deal with these three clowns? And And I want to help people, and I set a budget of about $50,000 that I thought I could raise through friends and all that. I'd go around and raise the money. We'd come up with a project, and then we'd put it in, and then I promised them I'd go back and judge it. And so that's where they first presented water. And water was very appealing to me because you can really measure the results. HIV positive is a terrible problem in Africa, but it's really hard to measure the results. It's just that a lot of people have it. But I knew that if we got the water and all that. So I went to Malawi and we put a water system in where we brought pipes out of the mountains, similar to the catchment, and brought it down to the village. The only problem was once the elephants came out of the mountains to raid the farmers' fields down below, they broke all our pipes. And I just said, you know, I got to really get involved in this, and I got to do a better job. That's before Dan and I met. And then it was a coincidence. I was in Rwanda, and Rwanda got ruined in the wars, and everything that we had done got ruined. And I just said, this doesn't make any sense. And World Vision said, we heard you used to work in Saudi Arabia. And I said, yes, I worked there for several years. And they said, well, how do you do with the Muslims? And I said, I do great. In fact, that my answer back was wrong today, but I drink and smoke with the best of them. And so I wound up in West Africa, and then Dana later joined me, and we really got into the drilling, and we got good at it. And then we started these programs and so forth. So some of it is coincidence of the church and the Nairobi slum, and then some of it is that you start getting it down, and then you know you've got a gift that you can bring. And a couple of the senior people from World Vision are here tonight. It's a two-way street. You knew some of the Dornsife's money, but we want to work with you on results because we're going to change people's lives together. And that's where we developed into where we are here. So it's a long story, sorry, but that's how it got started.
There's one other important goal to keep in mind, and that's that we've been at this now for, 15 to 20 years, and we had mentioned before that World Vision likes to go into an area development program and then stay for about 15 years and then leave. And we're just now in that time frame where World Vision is starting to back out of some of these area development programs, and we're working on that sustainability model, and so it will be very interesting to see what develops over the next few years. But hopefully within the next 5 to 10 years, we'll have many of our villages standing on their own 2 feet.
So we have time for one more question. The lady in the middle, halfway up, yes. Yes. We have seen the Peace Corps is very active that in sub-Sahara Africa, and that's where the Carter Foundation has really focused. So we have seen the incidence of it. One of the things that happens is that this is going to be hard to explain, so just take me at face value. The people in the village think the water, as it comes naturally, and even though it's contaminated, is sweet. They refer to it as sweet. And our water is not quite as sweet.
It has no taste.
It has no taste. So one of the problems we have seen with the screens is that they don't continuously use them. They say, I'll have two healthy ones and a couple of bad. It's like you eating a big steak and you're not supposed to. And the thing that we found with the borehole in the pump is that we stop it forever. There's no screens, there's no mistakes, there's no rips, there's no nothing, and we can really stop the guinea worm as a result of that.
I meant before you actually started throwing the before.
Well, we've seen that, but it's average effective.
And it's not our focus either. So.
And so bringing the borehole absolutely gets it stopped and the pump. Okay, thank you very much. Great questions.
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was wonderful. Thank you. Well, you should know that if anyone would like to go with the Dornsifes to Africa, just sign up. Just go and talk to them. Thank you so much for coming this evening. That was really wonderful. It was very special. And there is plenty of food. And also, it's my understanding, water and lemonade in the back. So feel free to socialize. And also, the Dornsifes will stick around and feel free to go and talk to them. Thank you for coming, and fight on.